Okay, we're going to talk about the statement of cash flows, and we're going to start by looking at the operating activity section using the indirect method. Okay, the only difference between the direct method and the indirect method is how you prepare the operating activity section. The investing and financing activity sections are identical. So I put a lot of information on the board. I'm going to describe what we have, and this is going to help us build the example. First, here's the information we're going to start with. Net income is $100,000, depreciation expense $15,000, gain on sale of equipment $3,000, and then we have the following changes in current assets and current liabilities. Accounts receivable decreased $12,000, inventory increased by $9,000, accounts payable increased by $4,000, and wage payable decreased by $2,000. This is for the difference between the beginning of the year balances and the end of the year balances. Now, some of these line items require a little bit of discussion, which is what I have here up here on the board. So when you prepare the operating activities section using the indirect method, your first line item is net income. So I'm going to put that up here. Net income, $100,000. Now, you don't necessarily have to put these in this order. I typically do. And so the first thing we're going to do is we're going to add back depreciation expense, and you would do the same for amortization expense on intangible assets that you amortize, or bond discounts or premiums that get amortized. Why do we add back depreciation expense and amortization expense? Because they are non-cash expenses. Let me give you a quick example. Assume that we have an all-cash business, and that all our revenues are received in cash, there are no accounts receivable. All of our expenses are paid in cash, there are no accounts payable, but we do have some equipment and we depreciate the equipment. So my revenues, all cash, $10,000, minus all my other expenses, $6,000, minus my depreciation expense of $2,000, ignoring income tax, would give us $2,000 net income. But I really have $4,000 cash, because when you expense depreciation, you debit depreciation expense, you credit accumulated depreciation. It does not require an outlay or a payment of cash. So here we really have $4,000 in cash. So what we're trying to do with the operating activity section is convert accrual basis net income to cash basis cash from operating activities. So we're going to add back the depreciation expense of $2,000, since we really have $2,000 more of cash than we're reporting as net income. So I'm going to add back my depreciation expense, which in our example, and we're using this these numbers on the far left, for example, is $15,000. Okay, so to avoid confusion, I'm going to erase this part now that we've discussed it. Second, if you have a gain or a loss on sale of property, plant, and equipment, then you have to understand what to do with that gain or loss. So let's take a look at this example here. Assume that equipment cost $50,000 and we've accumulated depreciation of $35,000 as of the date of sale. Now we sell the equipment for $18,000 cash. Our journal entry is to debit cash $18,000. Now, whenever you sell equipment, you want to remove both the equipment and the accumulated depreciation from your records. So you do that by debiting accumulated depreciation, and that'll give it a zero balance, so we debit accumulated. I'm going to credit the equipment account, since we no longer have the equipment, and a credit to the equipment zeros out that account. And then notice that if we were to add up the debits, it's 53, we credited equipment, we're missing a credit of $3,000. How do I know it's a gain? Because my book value is 50 minus 35, or $15,000, and I sold it for $18,000. When the amount that you sell it for exceeds the book value, you have a gain on sale, and in this example, we have a gain on sale of $3,000. Okay, now, we subtract the gain on sale. It seems like the opposite of what we should do. Here's why. In the investing activities section of the statement of cash flows, we're going to report sale of equipment, and that's a cash inflow of $18,000. And think of that $18,000 that we receive. It consists of the $15,000 book value plus the $3,000 gain. So that gain is included in this $18,000, and we're reporting it appropriately in the investing activity section, because all non-current assets, like property, plant, and equipment, any purchase or sale gets reported in the investing activity section. Now, you may recall that on the income statement, a multi-step income statement, gain on sale is reported right below operating income, what we typically refer to as the other revenue and expense section. So a gain on sale is other revenue. It's an increase. It increased net income. So that $3,000 gain is already sitting in the net income, but it's also being reported in the investing activity section, so it's being double counted. And for that reason, we're going to subtract gain on sale. I always like to put parentheses around a number we're going to subtract so we don't accidentally add it. Okay, so now I'm going to erase this so the board doesn't look quite as cluttered. And so we've addressed the two non-cash revenue and expenses in our example. Now we have to look at changes in current assets and current liabilities. Okay? Now, I'm going to give you an example of one current asset and one current liability, because all current assets behave the same way and all current liabilities behave the same way. Accounts receivable decreased by $12,000 from January 1st of this year to December 31st. So in our example here, on January 1st, we had accounts receivable of $40,000, and at the end of the year, my customers owe me $28,000, so that's a decrease of $12,000. Now, sales on account for this current year were $200,000. Okay, so during the course of the year, we debited accounts receivable for $200,000, and we credited sales revenue for $200,000. Debit AR, credit sales revenue for $200,000. So what that means is that my customers owed me a total of $240,000 this year. The $40,000 that we got from last year, that was relating to last year's sales, plus this year's sales on account of $200,000. And notice that at the end of this year, they only owe me $28,000. That means we must have collected the difference between these two numbers, which is $212,000. And I'll put it over here. We would debit cash, $212,000, and we would credit accounts receivable, $212,000. Now, on the income statement, net income is reported at $100,000, and that is based on revenue of $200,000. However, we collected $212,000. So we have $212,000, which is $12,000 more in cash than we're reporting as revenue on the income statement. Remember, the income statement is accrual basis. So we're trying to convert from accrual basis to cash basis. So what I'm going to do is, since we have $12,000 more cash because we converted some of last year's receivables into cash, I'm going to add that increase. Okay, so I'm going to add the decrease in accounts receivable of $12,000. Okay, again, it seems counterintuitive. You would think that, okay, since the decrease, we should subtract it, but it's really because we're converting receivables into cash. We have more cash than we're reporting sales. Now notice, if sales on account this year had been $300,000, I would debit $300,000, which means they owed me $340,000. And if they only owe me $28,000, that means I would have collected $312,000. There would be no difference. I'd still add $12,000. We don't really even need this number. We simply look at the beginning balance and the ending balance. And if a current asset, any current asset, we're looking at accounts receivable, really any current asset, if it decreased, that means we're going to add back that decrease when determining cash flows from operating activities. Okay, all current assets respond in a similar fashion. That is, we add a decrease and we subtract an increase. Now let's look at current liabilities, and for this example, we'll use wages payable. Okay, now I believe I used a slightly different number here to illustrate this point, but we'll then finish up our operating activity section after I explain what we do with a change in current liabilities. Suppose wages payable had we began with a balance of $5,000 January 1st. At the end of the year, we owed $4,000, so it went down by $1,000. Okay, assuming that wage expense for the year was $80,000, okay, then what I would have done is during the course of the year, I would have debited wage expense, $80,000, credit wage payable, and I'll just abbreviate $80,000. Okay, so that means during the course of the year, I owed my employees $5,000, which related to last year, the last payroll of the year, and this year, I had $80,000 of wages. So I owed them $85,000. If at the end of this year, I owe them $4,000, it means I must have paid them $81,000. I debit wage payable, $81,000. And I credit cash, $81,000. Okay? So again, now let's think income statement. Net income of $100,000 is based on revenues minus expenses. Included in that would be whatever your wage expense number was. Okay? So I expensed $80,000. Net income was reduced by $80,000. However, I actually dispersed $81,000. I dispersed an additional $1,000. Okay? So, when a current liability decreases, we do the opposite of what we did with a current asset. Notice that when a current accounts receivable decrease, we add back the decrease. When a current liability decreases, we're going to subtract the decrease because we dispersed more cash than we expensed on the income statement. Okay, so having said that, and again, all current liabilities respond in a similar fashion, let's just finish out our statement of cash flows operating activities section. Okay, so we added back a decrease in accounts receivable. That means I'll do the opposite for an increase in current assets. Inventory increased by $9,000. I'm going to subtract the increase in inventory of $9,000. Accounts payable, current liability, increased by $4,000 during the year. So I do the opposite of what I did for the current assets. I'm going to add the increase in accounts payable for $4,000. And last, just like we saw a moment ago, wages payable, in our example, decreased by $2,000. So I'm going to subtract the decrease in wage payable, $2,000. Okay? And that's going to give us cash provided by, assuming it's a positive number. If it's a negative number, we would say cash used by operating activities. Okay, and that number comes to $117,000. Okay, and that is how you do the operating activities section on the statement of cash flows using the indirect method.